joining us on the program. Ravens have ripped off three in a row. They put an end to the three in a row winning streak of Denver. This past Sunday at that 425 game, this man was up in the booth calling all the action. Baltimore 23, Denver 7, Femi Ayanbadejo. Good morning, Femi.
Good morning, gentlemen. How are you?
It was good hearing your voice in the booth yelling, hollering during that incredible pass from Lamar Jackson, that diving leap from Hollywood, who did not have a great game against the Detroit Lions. Do you feel like that game, that pass in particular, was sort of his redemption after a pretty bad one in Detroit?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you couldn't have had a more high wire act, an opportunity to kind of put the boo birds and commentary to bed. Hollywood's too talented to go out there and continue to struggle. And it was great to see him, man, on a play that was a 10 in regard to difficulty, because I thought when the ball was up in the air that maybe Lamar had overthrown him, but Hollywood hit that other gear, and you saw him get right under it. You know, he went vertical and horizontal and was able to pull it in. So I was really proud of him and happy for him.
I said earlier in the week, I think, we were talking about Hollywood and Lamar and their relationship and how they're real buddy-buddy. And do you think there is maybe some subconscious or maybe conscious favoritism on Lamar's part, where maybe some other guys aren't getting looked at enough? But then we did look at targets, and they seemed like they were spread out enough around all the guys. But I don't know. I just feel like...
So you're creating a controversy where there isn't one, okay, right? That's what you're doing right now. Yeah, okay. That's what you're doing, right? I think so. Maybe subconsciously you're creating controversy.
Maybe it's me.
Possibly,
okay.
Right? Yeah, so real talk, I do not think there's any favoritism. I do think that Hollywood is the most explosive receiver, and every team has one.
Yeah.
And he's the guy that's the go-getter, go-deep ball-getter. So he gets the attention and the targets he should get. If anybody is a favorite target, it's probably Mark Andrews, in my opinion, through the Lamar era. If you want to look at a small sample size, you could say it's Hollywood. But if you want to look at, since Lamar's been a starter in Hollywood, and Mark Andrews have been on the field together, I would say long-term, my intuition tells me it's Mark Andrews. But I think that Lamar takes advantage of what the defense gives him, a true point guard, a true distributor, throws to the open receiver. And sometimes he doesn't get to his second or third reading. Those guys could be those folks at times.
Right.
And other times Lamar extends the play. Whoever's best at scrambling drill and getting open is going to get the football. I don't think Lamar is, in his mind, oh, let me throw it to this person. The good ones don't do that. I think Lamar's a pretty damn good one.
So, Femi, maybe here's where some controversy does lie. We've been talking about it all morning. What's your take on the final play of the game where the Ravens finally tied the 43 consecutive games, running for 100 yards? John Harbaugh says it was his call. Vic Fangio from the Denver Broncos singing the Ravens' praises, Ozzie's praises, DaCosta's praises prior to the game. Changed his tune afterwards. Now he's all kinds of pissed off, saying that the Ravens have a lack of player safety. He thought it was BS. Yeah. What was your take on that?
Yeah, there's layers to this. One, Vic Fangio is the defensive coordinator a couple years ago that told his D lineman to submarine offensive lineman on the last play of the game that they had lost. He doesn't give a damn about player safety. They have the ball with a minute left. They're down by 16, and they're trying to score a touchdown. Their quarterback threw a ball into the end zone. They could have taken a knee. What happened to player safety then? Oh, that's only the Ravens. Only the Ravens should be caring about player safety. They want to get Drew Lock some reps, so it's okay to not worry about player safety when Vic Fangio in Denver has the ball. But when the Ravens have the football and there's a 40-year record that's been on the table that has numerous players across numerous teams who has put time into this, now all of a sudden it's a player safety issue. Vic Fangio is hypocritical, it's nonsensical, and it downright makes zero sense to me. He sounds like a child complaining and whining about something that didn't go his way. Either stop them, or don't let your quarterback throw the ball to the end zone, creating an opportunity with a few ticks on the clock for them to go get the record. Because I think at that point, the Ravens had conceded. They were okay with it. It was about winning the game. But hey, if we can win the game and get the record, I have absolutely no problem with it. And you can listen to people all around the country. If you're a Denver Broncos fan and a Vic Fangio supporter, you're probably going to side with him. If you're a Raven supporter and a John Harbaugh supporter, you're probably going to side with the Ravens. But at the end of the day, Vic Fangio's explanation is straight garbage, and yeah. I can't use the words I want to because I will get fired.
Go off, King. Go off, King.
And if I see Vic Fangio, you know what I'm going to say to that man.
Yeah,
that's
so
what I'm going to do to that man. You know what I'm saying.
Femi, to your point, we've actually been looking at some, like, Denver Reddit threads and fan sites and stuff like that.
Right.
They're not even coming to his side right now. I mean, even their fan base is going, my dude, you called three timeouts and tried to score during the last 10 seconds. There's not a lot of defending those comments.
No. And the bottom line is, I heard somebody and these idiots that think they know offense, the Ravens did not line up in victory personnel. They had Lamar in shotgun. Hey, let me tell you guys something. If you see a quarterback in shotgun, it's not victory personnel. If you see a quarterback in shotgun with a running back to his left and another back off the line of scrimmage, they are running a play. It is not victory personnel. So don't tell me, oh, they tricked them. It's victory personnel. I had a bunch of idiots saying that on Fox Sports and ESPN. Stop it.
You think they break it this Monday? They're playing Indy. Indy ain't looking great this season because they tied the consecutive record. Do they break it this Monday?
I say they break it because they're playing at home. And I'm going to say this off the record. I had a really great talk with Coach Mike Nolan and Greg Roman post game. We happened to catch him on the field, and he gave some insightful tidbits on the decision making and the thought process and how the running backs are coming along and some things that they're working on. Everything runs through this run game. I've said this. I don't need to quote Greg Roman. Everything runs through the zone read and the power run game, whether it's QB power, whether it's running back power, whether it's, you know, the mesh point and a little trickery. That is what is the foundation of this is. And guess what? The last couple weeks, teams have decided, Lamar, beat us with your arm. And we know this. Lamar had 400-plus pass yards on the field in Detroit. His receivers let him down. He had 300-plus yards left on the field. He acquired 300-plus yards on the field against Denver. And he did it in a pretty fairly easy manner with a bad back. So if teams want to say, you know what, let Lamar try to beat us down the field, the Ravens can run for 100 yards, not even trying to, because guess what? No matter what, 8-man box, 9-man box, 7-man box, 10-man box, they're still going to run the football. It's in their DNA. It's their identity. So I do believe that Denver has a stout defense. Who are they playing against? The Colts defense is not quite there. But I will say this, though. Carson Wentz, it's coming along. He looks really good as of late. And statistically, if you just covered up his name and don't let the recency bias of who he is and how we think he acts, if you just look at the numbers, he's playing pretty darn good football. And I remember not that long ago, he was playing with Philly, and they came back here down by 16 and were a two-point conversion away from tying the football game here after getting their ass kicked for most of the game. Let's not forget that. That was less than a year ago. And I remember that vividly. It stuck in my mind.
And speaking of the running game, just quickly before we wrap here, explain to me the Tyson Williams healthy scratch.
Yeah, okay, this is my reading the tea leaves. This is not me going to confirm what anyone has said, but I think that they need to know out of those four backs, you know, who is going to stay, who is actually a good fit, and I think they know what they have in Tyson. I believe he'll be back out there next week. I believe he'll be back out there next week.
Okay,
believe that he is the youngest and the most inexperienced, but I think he has the highest upside in regard to getting to the holes, making the right reads, and picking up the yardage that's there because of his athletic ability. I think he's that guy, but he's only that guy if he sees what the defense or the offensive line is blocking for him and understanding where his fit needs to be. If he does that, he, in my opinion, could be the most explosive back. But I want to see more of Le'Veon Bell. I saw a couple things that looked good, and I think that there's more meat on that bone with him, but it remains to be seen. But I expect Tyson Williams to be back out there on Monday night.
The Ravens are 3-1. Femi, you're 4-0 up in the booth with Jerry.
Yeah,
kicking
man.
Ass again. Looking
Great
forward
job.
To this Monday night. Femi, we appreciate your time.
Thank you, guys.
Take
appreciate
care.
It.